in the silence of the time that we spend together, speak to us of eternal things, that through patience and comfort of the Scriptures, we may have hope and be lifted above our darkness and distress into the light and peace of your presence, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The writer of Ecclesiastes says, there is a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build up, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to embrace and a time to refrain, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to be silent, time to speak, a time for love, and a time for hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. To everything there is a season, and a time to every purpose under heaven. At a time like this, we turn to the Word of God. The Word of God shows us something about our world that our culture doesn't show us. That there is supernatural involved in living. And that God gives us a way to connect with Him. And one way is to allow God to be the Lord of our life. The psalmist David penned the words of the 23rd Psalm. I'm going to read them now. If you know them, I'm going to be reading it in the King James Version of the Bible. If you want to say it with me, I think we have been turned on. If you want to say it with me, you can. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his namesake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord.
Good.
Thank you.
We had an intense lesson about exactly how to use this mic. Our colleagues still fail before it's over. The emotions kick in and everything. We'll see what happens. And just on behalf of the family, I want to welcome you here this afternoon. It means a lot to us that you took part of your beautiful, sunny marathon Saturday afternoon and were willing to spend it with us. And some of you have traveled quite a distance to be here with us. We're grateful. When the kids got together and we tried to decide after you passed away, what are we going to do? We looked back on my dad's life and we realized if you take the timeline from start to finish, he actually spent the biggest chunk of his life here in Maryland, 25 years plus. And he and my mom spent pretty close to half of their married life together here in Maryland. So we thought about to do the celebration of life here. So that you who have been so great to come out could share it with us. We fought hard, the 15 of us that we knew we were going to come down here, about who would draw a short straw and stand up here to say a few things about my dad. I obviously knew the shortest, I'm going first. And we really had to talk to each other about what we're going to say, because as I thought about it, I thought once the six of us are done, we will have created a little bit of a tapestry. Some of the things we say, we will say over and over again. And those will be the strongest, truest traits of who my dad was. And occasionally, one of us will pick out one thing that the rest of us don't say, and that will show you perhaps how God works in individual relationships to say the things that individuals need to hear from their father or their family member. So I'm just the fortunate one to get to go first. And I didn't want to take... When I thought about my dad, what I would say today, there were three words that came to mind. The first one is, and there may be a better word for this, but it's going to kick me out. I think my voice will project, so I'll do the best I can. The first word that came to mind is perseverance. And I mean that in a very, very good sense. My mom and my dad were married for 53 years before she passed. And then, I think it was 2008, the 14 of us, plus my mom and dad, took a cruise on the Thanksgiving week to commemorate their 50th anniversary. And they modeled for us, because marriage is truly a dear thing, but it's also hard work. And you have two personalities trying to act as one, and it's hard work. And they modeled that for their four children, and we're grateful. And so that perseverance part of who they are says a lot about my dad. The second one was fairness. Years ago, I was talking to a gentleman who had been an employee for my dad. My dad had a small manufacturer's rep business in the electronics industry. And the one thing this gentleman said to me, and we had only spoken a couple times previously, he said, bear with me. He said, your dad is the fairest man I know. And there were years when his employees, at the end of the year, made more money than he did, because that was the deal they had. The commission was their commission. He spent part of his time running the business. But that's, that's who he was. When it's all said and done, and you're fair, up and down the chain, that's when a corporate, whether it's a family, a business, a church, is strongest. And so I appreciate the fairness that was my dad. And third and final is grace. And what I mean that, he wasn't necessarily, you wouldn't look at my dad and go, there walks grace. Grasp
and this folks the time and ability. He had the ability to look ahead and sort of say, this might happen, this might happen, this might happen, this might happen. What will I do if this happens? What will I do if this happens? How will I deal with this? So that when the storms came, and they did, he was completely mentally and emotionally prepared for what that storm was. And as he grew on in life, and 70 years became 80 years, and 80 years became 90 years, he was 90 this past year. Infirmities come along with that. And so I got to see my dad gracefully deal with the infirmities that he long before that knew were coming. And I'll just leave you with one final story. When he dealt with macular degeneration for a long time before he passed. And that dreaded 80th birthday was coming when the DOT decides whether or not they're going to continue to allow you to drive. And so he was working between his eye doctor and the DOT, and he just wanted a decision to be made. So finally he calls up his doctor and he says, look, I don't care what you put in your letter that I'm supposed to carry to the DOT. Just tell me ahead of time, because if your letter says this man should no longer drive, I want to go and be able to buy a chauffeur's cap for my wife. That's just my personal snapshot of who my dad was. I'm going to let several other people come up and tell you a little bit about their glimpse of who he was. Please, many of you, over the last 30 years, may have spent as much or more time with my dad than we did. So we would love to hear some of your stories and some of your impressions as well after in the fellowship hall. So please come and share your experiences with us. It would mean the world to us. The mic's gone, but it's here.
Old-fashioned paper. I just wanted to tell you a couple things about my dad. First, the things that he was not. He was not a patient man. And that those of you who knew him knew that that was true. He was always ready for that at some point. But he always got things done, always. He was not flashy or excessive. But he counted every penny. He was not flashy or excessive. He counted every penny. And in fact, at one point, my sister and I were recalling a story when we were living in, in Boca, and my dad decided that the girls were going for too much toilet paper, so he decided to ask my mom, how much toilet paper does a girl need? So, yes, keep a mouth of toilet paper. And those who know him also know that he could be very stubborn. One of my favorite stories about my dad is that he would never let me pay for the bill. So I'm getting a little older and I'm doing okay for myself, but I wanted to treat my dad to dinner. Well, you didn't treat my dad to dinner, it just didn't work that way. Well, because I was in sales and my dad was always in sales, I decided one of my greatest challenges would be to figure out how I could pay for dinner. So I kept negotiating, and there was just no, dad wasn't having any of it, I was not going to pay the bill. But toward the very end, I said to my dad, and I'm thinking, there's got to be a way. What is it that I am, what's not happening here if I have to pay the bill? Why am I so insistent on trying to sell my dad on this idea? And I finally said, Dad, here's why I need to pay the bill. Because if I don't, you are robbing me of the joy of doing something for you. And boy, all of his defenses melted away, and he said, then you need to pay the bill. So I learned how to get to my dad. Because I knew there was something that I was getting from that transaction too, and I really did have joy in doing something for my dad. So here are other things about him that he modeled. Hank said a few of them, and I'm sure you'll hear some of them again. He was tough, but he was always fair. He had a very strong work ethic. We all started as teenagers. He actually suffered a heart attack in the dentist chair when he was in his 40s, I think. And we had a family meeting at that point. We were all very young. Mom and Dad said, okay, gather around. Here's what's going to happen. You are going to have to figure out how to work, and you're going to have to figure out how to support yourselves while you're here. So at 10 and 11, maybe it was 8 or 9, 10, 11, 12, it was, you're going to deliver the Boca News, and you're going to work. Every week you're back from school, you're working. And just in case I'm not here, you're going to have to figure out how to support yourselves and Mom. So that was kind of a wonderful privilege to have at that age. because all of a sudden, you know, there was no thinking that you're always going to be provided for, but figure out how to provide for yourself. I think that's been a blessing in all of our lives. He always had high expectations. He said, you can be anything you want. You can be a janitor, you can be a CEO, you can be a poet. You better be the best you've ever been. And I think each of us in our own ways has modeled that as well, and hopefully passed that down to his grandchildren. He believed in opportunity. He believed in truth and honesty. He believed in giving back. Service above self always. And I think everyone who knows him knows that whether it was Rotary or Crooked Keys here or Maryland Community Theater, my dad was here. He also loved connecting people, and I think part of that was just the salesmanship in him. He loved rallying people around and connecting people one to the other. And probably more specifically for me than anyone else in my family, he had a really strong love for Africa. And somehow I picked that up, lucky me. A few of my favorite moments were when he was invited to go to the Rotary International Convention in South Africa. And I figured as a daughter, since I'm the only one that really had a heart for Africa, I'm like, yeah, I want to go. See, I'm done. I look around my brothers and sisters, and they're like, it's yours, you can have it. I'm not interested. But I thought, you know, a Rotary International Convention with a bunch of old guys was probably going to be me shopping during the day and then went to long board meetings. That's not what happened. I attended the very first meeting with him, and my jaw was on the ground. I could not believe that I was in the midst of all these African countries working together to solve their problems, even though they work as individual countries instead of a continent. They knew that there was a lot before them that they had to do, and it was the most beautiful thing in the world. And that then led to me doing mission trips to Uganda, which I still do. And it just really developed a love for the continent and its people. And I really thank my dad for that. And secondly, my dad and I had sales talks a lot during the week, almost every day that I was driving home, because he would boast about selling another quarter-page ad in the American Community Theater directory to McDonald's. And he said, "Cap, it's $150. I'm like, "Guess what I did today, Dad?" So even at kind of through my career, I'm a grown woman and he's a grown man. We have this beautiful exchange about what I did and he did, or if I had a bad day, I lost a big account, and Dad was just like, "Hey, kiddo, you'll get the next one, I know you will." So he was always there, he was so encouraging, he was the best dad any of us could have.
We were the troublemakers. But honestly, all he had to do, if you knew my father's voice, was give me that stern look and talk in that deep bass voice he had, and you got the picture real quick. He taught us the value of the dollar, starting when we were quite young, as my sister said. If we wanted anything, we had to go get it ourselves. We would get the basics every year, but if you wanted the best or something new, you weren't going to get it. He instilled confidence in all of us. He made sure that as long as we gave everything the best that we could, that was the best we could do, and we should be happy with ourselves. Now, for those of you who know my father, he was a planner. You could not stand not to have an agenda, not to have a plan, or to fly by the man with the seat of his pants. Unfortunately, my sister and I inherited this from my father. The last time my sister and I were together, we saw my father this past Father's Day. At that time, he was kind of getting confused, and we had told him we'd be there a certain day for lunch, a certain day for dinner. So he got confused and accused us of not being planners. So my sister and I had to laugh about that, because now we had joined members of others that were already in that club, the Lack of Planners Club. While mentioning clubs, I became an exclusive club member of the 3 a.m. phone call club. And at that time, the stated members were my older brother and his wife, and my father's doctor. And yes, the doctor actually answered the phone twice at 3 a.m. in the morning with my father. So I became, there was like four of us, and we became members of that club, or I was allowed to do it. But he would just pick up the phone and call. He didn't know what time it was. He didn't know if it was night or day. But I sure wish, I know that my brother, my sister-in-law, and I still wish we were a member of that 3 a.m. phone call club. So for those of you who know my dad, I just want to say, you're your sports fan.
Sisters, when I came along, I could do no wrong. So I was a young innocent, and a lot of I moved to South Carolina, and I stayed in South Carolina after I was in college, and so I haven't been able to come down here and spend as much time with my father. But you know, the Sunday afternoons we always talked, and you know, we spent time out here on vacation, which was a great place to come. And so, but those were the times that were so special. But I remember a lot when I was younger, when I was like 8 or 9, my dad walked in my room one night, and he said, when I die, I want you to celebrate. Now, as a 9-year-old, you're going, what is that? I'm going to celebrate, like, do I don't like, you know? But it was one of those lessons I learned going, you know, and I was scared of death. And I was like, what does that mean? And suddenly I got the idea that he wanted us to celebrate, it, you know, in his life. And that's why we're here today. In fact, if my dad had his way, we'd have, you know, dancing girls and a chorus, and that's right. And you know, I know when he got to heaven, he was like, this is awesome, you know? And he's probably running to God every day, he's rejoicing. So, and that's why we're celebrating today. But back in the 80s, I don't know if you remember, there's a song called In the Living Years by Michael Buchanan. And God used that in my life to go, you know, I got some things I need to tell my dad. And so I guess I was like 25. And so I wrote this 4-page letter. Never written anything to my dad. My dad's version of I love you is, do you need anything? Okay, that was him saying love you. So I wrote this 4-page letter. It was like all the strength I had. And I sent it to him. Never heard much about it. But I want to share a few things from that. In the same line of what you've heard. So my dad was my strength for enjoying life, for being positive, for having integrity, for working hard and commitment and loyalty. And so, and I had this letter, but I left it back in South Carolina accidentally. But I do want to read, I did have some a little bit, but I do want to read that to you in just a second. But in this letter, I said, Dad, you were who taught me integrity and respect. And part of that is because when he would have a lot of friends over for parties. You know, I might be just talking with them, and they'd be like, you know, your dad, you're so fortunate that he's your dad. He's a great man. And I'd be thinking, well, I didn't feel that way when he talked to me the other day about something I shouldn't have done. But once again, I kept hearing that over and over. He taught me dependability. And in saying that, you know, he was, I remember playing soccer, and I was in Fort Lauderdale playing soccer one time. It was right over near Pinecrest in Fort Lauderdale. It was like 3 o'clock in the afternoon. I look over, and there's my dad in his suit. And I'm thinking, that's awesome. You know, he had so many things going on, so busy. You know, but he took time in his suit, it's hot, to, you know, watch me. So I mentioned that in my letter. The third thing is he's fair. And I know this is silly, but I'm going to bring this up. When I was young, I wrote this in my life. So when I was young, I asked Hank one time, I said, Hank, let's go play some ball. And Hank said, you know, and I was the little brother who was really, you know, I just get on people's nerves. So he'd go, no, not today. And so I said, Dad, do you want to play? And he's like, yeah. And Hank's like, oh, I want to play. And my dad looked at Hank and said, you know, you should have said yes to your brother. You know, and that made me feel so important. The next one is invincibility. As my sister said, they brought home boyfriends that were strong, rebellious, pretty juvenile. And so, how do we deal with my sisters is one thing. And I'm like, but, you know, they have to deal with my sister. But I knew that my dad would always get the better end of them. And I told him that. But he'd like to have fun, too. And when I was little, my dad would be in the car, and my son's probably go, that's where he got from. He would drive, he would just start zigzagging down the road, you know, just for fun. Until one time there was a cop behind us. I was like, oh, this would get interesting. By the grace of God, he pulls over. But my dad, you know, he'd always play the piano with his toes at Christmas parties. I don't know if he ever did that here, but he liked to be the life of a party. And I told him that. I said, let me just finish. I have to read it off my phone here, but let me just finish finish this letter. And I think this is so true of what we're talking about today. And I'll say before I read this that after a while, I said, Dad, did you get that letter I wrote? He said, yeah, do you know something I don't know? I said, no, Dad, you're not dying or anything. I just, you know, it was just for my heart. But end of this letter, I said, those were fun times. I appreciate the things you did, and I was with them. They were the best. I can go on and on with thoughts and memories. But all comes down to, I love you, and you are good. And after that, it was I've never said I love you to my dad before. But in the 15 years after that, or the 2025, we said I love you every time. And so sometimes, you know, like my dad, it was there. And he saw me over time, as some of you may have seen. But he was the best. And he did good. And now he's celebrating with Christ in heaven. So we're thankful for that.
They just took him at that and said, I'm all okay, I guess his name's Kreh.
to give himself his own nickname. He's been using it for 60, 70 something years. Maybe I need a little practice. I've been walking around for about a year, and I have yet to have somebody call me John the Dragon, right? But I'm going to keep trying. You take a look at his picture, and you see those big ears and his big mouth, and you think, man, I bet that guy's got a voice. I bet he's got a knack for music. And that he did. I got the pleasure this probably while I was in high school about 6 years ago to see him in his retirement community choir. It's called Knox Rocks, and in between all the goofy antics of elderly men in tutus dancing and this guy doing something called Ething, where it just sounded like he was really struggling to breathe. There are these big, beautiful songs, and amidst a choir of 50, 60, I'm pretty sure I can still hear my grandpa. But he also had a real softness about what he sang. Still to this day, the most pure picture of romantic love that I can think of is on that cruise my dad was talking about. Him and my grandma singing to each other. Different. Celebrating the life that they had together. I thought I got it all out.
Grab it.
friends back in Boca have been going through a Bible study, and we're reading the late part of Ephesians 5, beginning of Ephesians 6. And it talks about how fathers should treat their children and how husbands should treat their wives and vice versa. And it's a movie Bible study. So the guy who put the Bible study together said, one of the greatest determinants of if somebody is living a Christian life is how they treat their family. And as I was preparing to speak, I thought, wow, he was living it well. And that's seen by the way he did tough love, and the way he was so generous, and the way he passed down all his values to his kids, and then to his grandkids. So here's the book, Kreh, one of the best characters ever written.
Picked up two palm fronds that we cut and stacked up, and he's dragging them down the street. We're like, Grandpa, you don't have we're here to do that for you. And he wasn't having it, you know, before at his house, he was going to help. The second thing, and some people have touched on this, is just he taught me the importance of positivity and being positive. And it, I used to remark about the way I never heard him really express negativity. He lived out that saying that if you don't have anything nice to say, don't say it at all. And that probably stood out to me because I tend to be a cynical person and a sarcastic person, and it was important for me to see that. And one of the ways, this is silly, but it always stood out to me, is mealtime. We would have one for dinner. We'd be at his house for dinner and move for dinner. Didn't matter where we were. I never, ever heard him express anything other than positive thoughts about his meal. And I'm sitting there like, I'm eating all the same meals he'd eat, and he's sitting, like, some of them are definitely better than others, some are great. So I learned, I started watching, like, I'm going to learn to figure out his, I'm going to crack his code. And so I think I figured it out that if it was real good, you know, you'd get a, well, that was just fantastic, or that was just superb, I'll prompt it. And the other times, he would just be kind of quiet after dinner, and someone would say to him, oh, Dad, you finished up it, wasn't it? And he'd say, oh, well, you know, it wasn't bad. And that makes sense if you're with people you know and people you love, you wouldn't say something bad. That's the type of gentleman he was. But man, like, we'd be at a restaurant, we'd be at Olive Garden at 4:30 in the afternoon, and he wouldn't say a bad thing. He didn't know what that good was, but he didn't complain, and I've always, that's always stuck with me, just the way his positivity. And the third thing is the importance of family and community. Grandpa Boo made it a point when we were growing up. Uncle Bill kind of alluded to this. To call and check in on the family every weekend. Everyone in our house would always know for a couple seconds he was on the other line, because you'd have to raise your voice a couple notches and crank up the volume. And go, oh, Grandpa's calling. And we all kind of line up for our turn to talk to Grandpa. And he was a man of few words on the phone. But despite that, he made sure to take the time to talk to me and all of my siblings. And he always cared about what was going on in our lives. You know, hey Phil, how's soccer going? Hey Doug, how's drama? How's the play coming? Because he was invested. He cared what was going on in our lives. He wanted to know about what was going on in our lives. So we fill him in, you know, we get the classic, well, hey there, sports fan, that's just superb. The other thing is, none of our birthdays ever went by without getting a call from him, or him and Boo, or a voicemail serenading us with his rendition of Happy Birthday. There was no mistaking the way he cared about his family. And when he wasn't loving on his family, it's because he was busy loving on his community. At every stage of his life, he was plugged into and leading into community, whether that was his prep school, Pingree, whether that was with his fellow Bulldogs at Yale, in his adult life with the Rotary Club, and then in marathon here was the community theater, and this community that kindly associates with us today, Kirk of the Keys. And even when he moved to John Knox Village up in Pompano, he was active in community, like Jamin referenced, you know, singing in plays and things like that. Wherever his house was, Baltimore, Boulder, Marathon, his door was always open. And if he knew you were coming, and here he did, because we would have to pay just through the gate and serve key, and we'd pull around that last turn into the driveway, and Grandpa would always be up there waiting at the top of the stairs. With that big bud Kreh smile, and whenever it came time to leave, whenever the weekend was up, as we pulled out of the driveway, you know, turned the driveway on our way home hit the road, he'd be back at the top step, offering just a hearty wave, you know, said, couldn't wait for you to get back. When I came up here a couple minutes ago, I introduce myself as Philip. That's how people know me. It's how I'm coming at work. But my full name is Henry Philip Kreh. My father goes by Hank. His name Henry Stephen Kreh. And God willing, my wife and I are one day with a son. I truly cannot wait to name him Henry Philip the Blind Kreh. In a very literal on paper way, I am part of Henry Bud Kreh's legacy. But legacies are more intangible than that. To me, the word legacy is the imprint that an individual leaves on the world. In my grandfather's case, it was the way that he left every community he was a part of, every community he passed through, a better place than when he got there. And I think we in this room are a manifestation of his legacy. Friends and family alike, because if you were friends with Bud, you were essentially family with Bud. He loved you in that way. And so I know we all remember the way you modeled service and sacrifice and hard work. We were all loved fiercely by Grandpa. I remember that twinkle in his eye when he smiled at you. And that big smile almost always turned into a hearty chuckle. And above all, I remember a man who truly knew the meaning and power and the importance of family and friends. I'll leave you with this. I imagine most everyone in this room has experienced a Bud Kreh toast. I never knew him to let a dinner go by without raising one. And they were always carefully chosen, powerful words, and I admire that. So in honor of that, to close, I'd like to metaphorically raise a glass and offer the following toast to Bud. Here's to you, Grandpa. Your legacy echoes behind you, the family and friends you love so well. I couldn't be prouder to share your name. Give Lou a big hug for you. I love you.
I am an only child. Wow, it would have been unbelievable if I could have been you. I think all of us feel a real strong connection to you and your sharing about him. I want to turn our attention back to the Word of God. And I want to read some words from the lips of Jesus. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Counselor of the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave you. My peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. And then turning to words of the Apostle Paul, in face of all of this, what is there left to say? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not hesitate to spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, can we not trust such a God to give us with him everything else that we can need? Who would dare to accuse us whom God has chosen? The judge himself has declared us free from sin. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ even prays for us. Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Can trouble, pain, or persecution? Can lack of clothes and food, danger to life and limb, or the threat of the force of arms? No, in all these things we want an overwhelming victory through him who has proved his love for us. I have become absolutely convinced that neither death nor life, neither messenger of heaven nor monarch of earth, neither what happens today or what happens tomorrow,
neither a power from on high nor a power from below nor anything else in God's whole world has any power to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Would you bow your heads and pray with me? And now I pray, O Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts would be pleasing to you. And we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. The last thing that Jesus said to his disciples before he was raised into heaven, he said, "I will always be with you." I believe he picked those words very carefully. I think he wanted them to remember the last thing he said. And the reason that he wanted them to know that was life is not easy. Life wasn't easy back in Jesus' day. And to follow God, it's not easy in our day. He could say to them that he would be with them always because he had a different meaning of the word always. Now, they didn't understand that, but they remembered it. Somebody wrote it down, and we have those words. I will be with you always. He could be with them always because he had called every one of them by name to come and follow him. And they did. I believe that God called Bud's name. And I believe that Bud followed Christ. There's a story that goes around of a tightrope walker in Niagara Falls who, from the Canada side to the American side, walked across the tightrope. And everybody cheered and everybody was excited. Wow! What a hard thing. Went back to the other side, pushing a wheelbarrow. And everybody cheered. Wow! He went back over in a wheelbarrow. And then he addressed the crowd and said, "I'm going back over, but I need a volunteer to sit in the wheelbarrow." And there was silence. You see, in a hypothetical way, I believe that when Bud Kreh drew his last breath, that Jesus came and said, "I want you to get in the wheelbarrow, Bud, and I want you to come across this chasm because I prepare a place for you." And I believe Bud knew exactly where he was going so that he would be with his wife and look for his family. You see, the most important thing that you and I have to do today is we have to grieve his loss. You see, when you've got a strong patriarch in a family, he needs to be praised. You get that from God. God wants all of us who say we love him to come and praise him and to thank him for eternal life. And I believe that remembering Bud in a positive way, as his family has showed us, is the right thing to do. I also believe that in giving honor to Bud, in giving praise to God, that we fulfill God calling us. But you see, we've got another step. We've got to believe that if we have faith in Jesus, we'll get in wheelbarrow and we'll go to the other side. Faith is strong. Bud lived out that for his family. And you and I need to live that out for our family. Jesus could tell his disciples that he would be with them always because he knew their name. He called them to follow him, and they did. And also, he knew where he was going. He has prepared a place for Bud, and he's prepared a place for you and me. And if we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we need to leave our lives heaven back. You see, that's what God wants for us. Bud got it. He puts us in this world so that people could see that we love Jesus by the way we love each other. And by the way we love our community. And by the way we serve.
You see, when God calls us by name, it's not a free ticket to heaven. It's a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle of following Jesus and allowing His Spirit to be a part of our spirit. And so we can grieve our father and our grandfather and our friend. We can grieve him, but we don't need to grieve him as people with no hope. We need to grieve him knowing where he is and knowing that we are on the same trail. Not only could Jesus tell his disciples that he would be with them forever because he knew their name and he knew where they were going and they were going to heaven, but that he was going to leave them something to help them get there. He said, if I don't ascend to go to the Father, you won't have my Spirit. And so he left his Spirit. And his Spirit dwells in each one of us. His Spirit helps us to grieve Bud's loss. You see, I like the stories where there's a toast. And I like the stories where there's fun. And I like the stories where there were rebellious daughters. I raised one of those. So there's nothing wrong with life, and there's nothing wrong, but we got to claim the Spirit. That's why Jesus left. So he leave a piece of him for us. And that we can grieve by knowing that we belong to Christ. So today I think it's honorable that the family give us a snapshot of that. Those of you who knew him here in Kirk and community theater, you've got your shot. So today we give honor to Bud and glory to Christ. Will you pray with me? Oh God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all of your servants who, having lived this life in faith, live eternally with you. Now we thank you for your servant Bud, for the gift of his life, for all that you have given him that was good and kind and faithful. We thank you that for him death is over and pain is ended, and he has entered the house that you have prepared for him. O God, in Jesus Christ, you promised many homes within your house. Give us faith to see beyond touch and sight some sign of your kingdom, and where our vision fails, to trust your love, which never fails. Lift our sorrow and give us good hope in Jesus, so we may bravely walk our earthly way and look forward to glad heavenly reunion through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was dead but is risen, to whom we honor and praise both now and forever. Amen.
Feel free to sing along with us. You will probably know this one.
Thank you.
you and give you peace, both now and in the life everlasting.